So I think that the title here deserves an explanation. So for the past, I don't know, at least 5 or 10 years, I've been trying to defeat decoherence. So hence the title. I wanted to talk about the enemies of decoherence. But after recalling all these memories and remembering how Wojtek has always given me many opportunities throughout my career, I thought it was a bit unfair to talk about the decoherence and enemies at a place where we're supposed to be celebrating decoherence. So the talk will be about failed enemies of decoherence. So it's not just failed attempt, but no-go theorems. Okay, we'll talk about something that we would like to do, build, engineer a true enemy of decoherence. And in this talk, I will try to show that this is not possible in some circumstances. So let me try to motivate this by, asking a simple question. Why is a classical memory so stable? Okay, you can you encode information on the hard drive of your laptop. You can literally drop it on the floor, and it will very likely remain encoded. So let's say that we wanted to build a classical memory out of a ferromagnet, like this here. So we have all spin down, that's zero, all spin up, that's one. And of course, unavoidably, the information is going to be corrupted. Well, not the information, but the memory may suffer some small errors like this. And if this is a ferromagnet, of course, this will cost you, okay? Because now you've flipped a spin and you now have two frustrated neighbors, and this will cost you 2 units of energy. But if you flip another spin, well, now you've reconciled yourself with a neighbor and you still have just 2 frustrated neighbors, so this didn't cost you anything extra. And you can go on like this, and eventually you can flip the entire chain at a very low energy cost, just a constant, okay? However, if you move on to 2 spatial dimensions, things are fundamentally different. So now, if you flip a spin, now you have 4 frustrated neighbors. That's not an important difference. However, if you flip 2 spins, now you have 6 frustrated neighbors. And more generally, if you create an error droplet, you will pay a price that is proportional to the boundary of the droplet, okay? Because the domain wall in 2 spatial dimension are 1-dimensional objects, while they were point-like in 1 dimension. So we would say that the 2 states, the 2 ground states of the system, are separated by an energy barrier. And this energy barrier grows like the square root of the number of bits, right? Because it's a boundary issue. So now if you remember from statistical mechanics that the probability of a certain configuration is exponential minus the energy, well, you deduce from this that it is very, very unlikely that random bit flips will flip the entire memory from one configuration, one ground state, to the other. So of course you can do it if you have global errors, like flipping the entire system. But if you want to do it by a sequence of local moves, you have to overcome this energy barrier that grows with the system size. Okay, so there's much more to this story, but I want to keep things simple just to motivate the rest. Okay, so let us try to make a quantum memory out of this ferromagnet. So it's not hard. All you need to do is put the configuration inside KETs, and now you say, well, now this is a quantum system, and in principle, I can prepare this state here, which is a coherent superposition of the 2 classical memory states. Now, this is a degenerate system. These 2 states have exactly the same energy, and therefore, this, if you prepare this, if it wasn't for decoherence, this would remain, a coherent superposition. It would remain stable at all time. Now, the important thing about this system is that it has a local order parameter, sigma z. What this means is that it has 2 ground states, and the system spontaneously chooses one or the other, and you can tell which one it chose by measuring just a single spin, okay? If you measure sigma z on a single a spin, you will learn whether all the spins are up or all the spins are down. So now imagine coupling to a single spin, okay? Let's turn on a magnetic field that couples to a single spin. Well, now the two ground states are no longer ground state, they're actually split, okay, by something which is proportional to this magnetic field. Okay, and now let's plug this in Schrodinger's equation and let's time evolve this superposition. Of course, one will pick up a negative phase and the other one will pick up a positive phase, nothing surprising here. So here's the density matrix corresponding to this state. And now here's the important bit. Suppose that you don't know the magnetic field, possibly because it's caused by coupling to the environment, and this is something that fluctuates. Well, then you should integrate over the value of the magnetic field, and what you get is disappearance of the off-diagonal terms. Okay, that's decoherence. So the quantum superposition has turned into a statistical mixture. So you see that if you have a quantum system, or any system, that has a local, the moral is this. If it's easy for you to tell which ground state it is, it's easy for the environment. And if it's easy for the environment, then it won't stay. It won't stay in a superposition, okay? So you don't want to have any local order parameter in your system. Okay, so are there systems? So you see, the point is that by coupling to only a single spin, you can make the spectrum of the Hamiltonian fluctuate. Okay, you can change the eigenvalue. So this is something we must absolutely avoid if we want to store quantum information.
Sorry.
Yes?
Just very basic. What's the difference between the local observable and the local order parameter?
They're the same thing. They're just two names for... I mean, a local order parameter is a local observable that tells you which state it is. Which of the two ground state. Okay. So you see that the goal here is to try to engineer a Hamiltonian whose eigenvalues are very, very stable. They don't change in time. And, a couple of years ago, Bravi, Hastings, and Mikulakis have proved that certain systems have this property. So as we already saw, the system must have no local order parameter. This is absolutely necessary because I just shown you a mechanism that will make the spectrum fluctuate whenever you have an order parameter. It wasn't important that it was a ferromagnet or anything else. They needed another condition, which is that the system is locally consistent. This one is mathematically a little bit more involved, so let me just try to explain with an example. Here's a Hamiltonian that is not locally consistent. Again, it's a ferromagnet. All the spins want to be aligned, but this particular spin 23, wants to be pointing down, okay? So as you're building, imagine that you're building the ground space starting from the first two spin and then you include the third and you move on like this. All of a sudden when you include site 23, the ground state manifold changes abruptly, okay? That's what being non-locally consistent means. It means that by looking globally at the ground state or locally, you get two very different answers. So, under these two conditions, they could show, they were able to prove mathematically that the system has a stable spectrum, meaning that if you turn on any local perturbation, okay, on extensive perturbation, so one on every site, you will not change the spectrum. Okay, it will only change by an exponentially vanishing amount. And therefore, this is a long-lived memory at zero temperature. Okay? So the question I want to address in this talk is, can we combine this spectral stability with the thermal stability of the 2D Ising model? Okay. And I will provide some evidence that it cannot be done. So why is this interesting and why should this be called the enemy of decoherence? Because this would be a system that uses coupling to the environment, because coupling with the bath is crucial to get the Boltzmann factor. Right, this Boltzmann test factor from statistical mechanics comes from the coupling to a heat bath. So this system would use the coupling to a heat bath to fight decoherence. Okay, it would remain stable not only in spite of decoherence, but because of decoherence. Of course, for quantum information, it would have practical application. Essentially, it would be a quantum hard drive. It's something that you could store quantum information in it, leave it alone, and then come back a day after, and it would still be there. we know how to maintain coherence in principle for arbitrary long time using fault-tolerant quantum computation. But this is substantially different because there's no need for any active intervention. Okay, the system is thermally stable just on its own. But also, just from the point of view of fundamental physics, I believe that this could be very exciting if we could achieve this. Because, we could imagine if we were able to engineer something like this, it would provide an example where coherent unitary evolution emerges as the low energy, low temperature effective description of something that is fundamentally noisy. Okay, and this, I believe, could have could tell us something new about black hole information loss paradox, because the unitary quantum theory, as we all know in Cherish, could maybe emerge from a theory which is fundamentally not unitary, but it would just be a low temperature phenomenon. Okay, now there is a known example of this, and it's Kitaev toric code, but it lives in 4 spatial dimension. Okay, so really here the question is, can this be achieved in lower spatial dimension? Can we do this in 2 dimensions? Okay, so here's an outline of the rest of the talk. So this first point is only like to set the playground. Just what's the mathematical structure that I will be studying? And then there's this holographic disentangling lemma from which everything else will follow. Okay. So these, I will just flash these results. They're kind of trivial corollary of the holographic disentangling lemma. So let's just start by setting the playground. As I said, the goal is to take the system from 4 dimension to a lower dimension, and here I will focus on 2 spatial dimension. Okay, so we have a lattice of a 2D lattice, and every site is occupied by a D-level quantum particle. It could be 2, it could be 10, it doesn't matter. Okay, and the Hamiltonian has the following form. Okay, so X label regions. Okay, so you can have like 1 body interaction, 2 body interaction, 3 body interaction, anything. But I assume that these terms all have a finite range. So if you X is a region of the lattice, if the region is too big, there can be no term on this. Okay, so this W is the interaction range. Okay, so this thing has a finite range, and this is what it means for it to live in 2 dimension. Okay. So local Hamiltonian in 2D. The other absolutely crucial hypothesis that I will make here is that the terms in the Hamiltonian mutually commute. Of course, this is a very strong requirement. The reason why I make it is not so much because I think it's nice. It's because otherwise I can't prove anything. Okay. However, I mean, yes.
Could you just have them commute on the ground, say like the frustration free
Hamiltonian? No, not quite. I need this. I mean, this is the next obvious step, but I don't know how to do it. Okay.
Are you saying that all of these D-level quantum particles are uncoupled from one another?
No. These things couple them. You see?
It's just a direct sum of.
No.
P
are just terms in the Hamiltonian. So 1 body term, 2 body terms.
I see.
X labels a subset of particles.
So if V equals 2, for example, each Px could be the sum of a lot of sigma matrices.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so, and I also want to try to defend this assumption a little bit. I think it's like folk belief that every phase of matter, if you do Rg at the fixed point, the Hamiltonian has this property. Okay, like that you can represent every phase of matter by something like this. I don't fully buy this because I don't think you can do system with chiral order. But anyway, maybe I shouldn't say that. The last thing I'm gonna assume, and this is not important at all, is that the P are projectors. The point is that whether you pay an energy 0.5 for being in that state or 1 doesn't make any difference. So I may as well assume that these just have 0 eigenvalue and 1 eigenvalue. So either like you're in the ground state or you're not. So this is just for mathematical simplicity. It doesn't change anything. Okay, so now we have this Hamiltonian. We're encoded the information in the ground state of this Hamiltonian. Okay, so the code is The plus one eigenstate of all these projector, because there was a minus here, okay? It's the ground space of the Hamiltonian, or it's the image of the projector obtained by taking the product of all these projector. These are all equivalent definition. So you know, physicists should just keep this in mind. It's just a ground state of this local Hamiltonian, but you know, if you're into quantum information, this is an error correcting code. With proper coarse graining, I mean, if the interaction range is 20, just take groups of 20 particle and call them one big particle, okay? So you can always bring the system up to coarse graining. You can assume this is the picture you should have in mind. Okay, so the interaction range is 2, and you have a regular square lattice because every lattice in 2D is regular square up to coarse graining, okay? So this is the picture you should have in mind. You have interaction between groups of 4 particles like this, all neighboring each other, okay? So each of these orange squares is meant to represent like any type of interaction between these particles. Yes?
So when you coarse grain, does the interaction
between
these new particles?
No, I mean, by coarse graining, I really mean here are 20 particle, I'll call them just one particle now. So I'm not mathematically changing, it's just relabeling. Okay, I make supersites. Okay, so a lot of examples that fall into this category: Kitaev's third code, Bombay's topological color code, Levin-Wen string net model, Turev Vero code, the quantum double models of Kitaev, and I would say most models that we know with topological quantum order fall into this setting that I've just described. Okay, so. I'll just go over an example with you. This is Kitaev's code. I'm sure most of you have seen it before. Qubit lids live on the edge here, and we assume periodic boundary condition, therefore it's a torus. And so here are the terms in the Hamiltonian. One of them is sigma z, tensor sigma z, tensor sigma z, tensor sigma z, so 4 tensor product of sigma z around a site. Remember that the qubit live on the edge here. And another term is sigma z, similarly with sigma z. So these are the term in your Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian is like minus the sum of these guys and the sum of these guys. It's easy to check that they mutually commute. As I said, they should. Of course, x commutes with x, z commutes with z. But x and z anti-commute. But you see that every time you have an overlap of one of those with one of those, they overlap twice at 2 locations. Therefore, they commute. Okay. Okay, so here is a symmetry of the Hamiltonian. It's a string of z that wraps around the torus. This is a symmetry of the Hamiltonian. How do you see that? Well, it commutes with every term in the Hamiltonian. Of course, it commutes with the sigma z terms. But if it, again, the same story, right? Every time it overlaps with one of the sigma x term, it overlaps twice. Therefore, it's a symmetry. And this is what tells you that the ground space is degenerate, because you have a symmetry operator. And the last thing I want to show you is what happens if you have if you have errors. So let's suppose that we flip one of the qubits. So this is sigma x is the bit flip operator. Well, this bit flip does not commute with this plaquette. Okay? So this plaquette used to be in like its plus one eigenstate. Now it's going to be in its minus one eigenstate. So since the energy is the sum of all these plaquettes, now you have like a little energy density at this location, okay? A little particle. And similarly for the guy on the right, okay? So for flipping a bit, it costs 2 units of energy, much like in the 1D Ising model. Okay, now what happens if we create another X error? Now here's the important bit. Of course, now this guy is excited, this guy's excited, but the guy in the middle got flipped twice, okay? So it's no longer excited. And you can go on like this. So you see, it's much like in the 1D Ising model. You can flip, spin, and continue, and you could do this, and you only pay an energy for the endpoint of the string. So if you, you do something like this, where you take one of the endpoints and you wrap it around, and you apply one last error, what you have done is you've applied a symmetry operator, therefore you've changed the encoded information. This is like flipping the logical bit, and it's only cost you 2 units of energy. Okay, so it's much like the 1D Ising model. Okay, and this is the kind of thing that I would like to generalize in this talk. Okay. Okay, so when we think of the system, what are, yes?
What's in four dimensions?
No, this was in two dimensions. Okay, so the toric code in two dimension is much like, in terms of thermodynamics, is much like the 1D Ising model, because the domain walls are point-like. If you take a four-dimensional toric code, thermodynamic is much like the 2D Ising model. Okay, so it has the domain walls are string and they have tension. Okay, much like the 2D Ising model. So this example that I just shown is not thermally stable because of that. Okay. A few standard definition. So now you take a lattice and imagine a subset of the lattice, a small region. We'll see that it's correctable if essentially you can throw it out and recover the state. Okay. So if you can take a bunch of qubits, throw them in the bit bucket, and then from this reconstruct the ground state without knowing what it was, you know, you just know it was a ground state, you don't know which one. But if you can recover from this, we'll say that the region is correctable. And because of what I just argued before, this is the same as saying that there's no order parameter on this region, and mathematically this is known as the Knill-Laflamme condition in error correction, which says that any operator on the region M in the ground space looks trivial. Okay. These are all equivalent statement. So now that you get the idea of a region being correctable, the minimum distance of a code is simply the smallest non-correctable region. So if you turn this on its head, it tells you if you have a region and it contains less qubits than the minimum distance, then you can throw away this region without damaging the information. And lastly, a logical operator is something like we just saw, this string of X operator in Kitaev's code. It's something that takes you from one ground state, and when you apply this logical operator, you get another ground state. Okay? It acts inside the ground space, and of course it must act on a region bigger than the minimum distance. Okay. So these are the logical operators. So of course, what are the desirable feature of a code? We want to have a minimum distance that's as large as possible, okay, to have very robust information. Yes?
Is there any difference in the framework you set up between logical operator and order parameter?
No, in fact, it's the same thing. Yep. Well, yeah, I'll stick to that answer. Okay, so now let me state that one of the kind of main mathematical result. It's not so interesting on its own, but you can derive so many things from it. So instead of reading the four, well, so I should acknowledge it was derived with Sergey Bravi and Barbara Terhal, and I'll show it to you with pictures, just a statement. So here's the entire lattice in white, and here's a region on this lattice in gray. Let's assume that M is correctable, maybe because it's smaller than the minimum distance. And also let's assume that the boundary is correctable. What's the boundary? The boundary is simply like a ribbon, okay? Because the boundary is really just a 1D object, but let's just thicken it a little bit to include one side inside and one side outside. So it becomes a region on its own. So here would be the union of B and C. So this is what I call the boundary of M. Okay, it's just a thickened boundary. Let's assume that both M and the boundary of M are correctable. Okay, then here's the result. There exists a unitary transformation that acts only on the boundary, so here on B and C, so it acts on all the qubits in the boundary, such that if you start with any ground state, okay, and you apply this unitary, what you get is a tensor product between the inside and the outside. Okay, so this unitary, as it says, it disentangles the inside from the outside. And moreover, the state that you get on the inside does not depend on what ground state you started in. It will be the same state regardless of what ground state you started in. Okay, so essentially, you can view this unitary that acts on the boundary of a region. It just kind of pushes out all the quantum information. It leaves the inside in a pure state that contains no information about what was there initially. And all the information has been pushed out of the region. Okay. Now this is a very powerful result, and let me just give you an example. So let's go back. Consider a trivial code. What I mean by this is a code that has just one state. Okay, you can't encode information with just one state, right? If I just keep telling you 0, 0, 0, you don't learn anything. Okay, so you need at least two states. But let's take a trivial code. It has just one state. Well, then every region is correctable. In fact, I can lose the entire system, and I haven't lost. I could reconstruct it because there's no ambiguity. So in that case, this is always true. M is always correctable. Yeah, boundary is always correctable. And then this thing just gives us the area law for many-body system. The area law, remember, it tells us that if you have the ground state of a many-body system and you take a region, its entropy is proportional to its boundary. Okay, that's the area law. Here, what we're showing is that you can construct the ground state. I'm going to read like this theorem in reverse by taking a tensor product and then acting just on the boundary. So if you act only on the boundary, you can't create more entropy than the size of the boundary. So you can really view this as a generalization of the area law. Okay, so I won't prove the result, but let me show you some applications. Here's the first one, which might be a bit surprising. A region is correctable if its boundary is smaller than the minimum distance. Okay, so remember that the definition of the minimum distance is take a region, look at its size. If it's smaller than the minimum distance, it's correctable. Right? That's the definition of minimum distance. It's the smaller number of qubits you need to corrupt the information. Here I'm saying, no. If you take a region and you ask me if it's correctable, I don't need to look at its volume. All I need to do is look at its boundary. If the boundary is small enough, I know it can be corrected. And that's because we're in 2D. Okay, so it's very special. So bulky errors are not problematic because they have a very large like bulk to boundary ratio. But the skinny errors are problematic. Okay. And in fact, this result, it follows so simply that I can prove it to you. So here's M. It's a correctable region. And let's suppose that M is very, very small. So it's less than a minimum distance, therefore it's correctable. And its boundary is also less than a minimum distance, therefore it's correctable. So both M and the boundary of M are correctable. Okay. This means that we can lose all the qubits in the boundary of M, and we won't lose the information. So let's do that. Let's trace out the boundary, okay? Let's trace out the boundary. So we're left with a state on A and a state on D. We've traced out B and C. But the holographic disentangling lemma tells us that this density matrix on A and D is actually a tensor product between the inside and the outside, and moreover, that the inside is a known state. It's a known state independent of the ground state we started in. So we may as well throw this part away. Okay, it's known. So we can throw it in the bit bucket, and this shows us that we can not only tolerate erasing M and tolerate erasing its boundary, we can tolerate both at the same time. Because now if you erase M in its boundary, all I need to do is re-prepare this state, put it in the middle, and then correct for erasing the boundary. Okay? So what this shows is that if M and its boundary are correctable, then so is the union of M and its boundary. So I've just made it bigger. So let's continue, okay? And let's iterate until this second assumption is no longer true, okay? Until the boundary is no longer correctable. When does this happen? When the boundary is larger than a minimum distance, okay? So this shows that we can grow the region until the boundary is bigger than the minimum distance, and this proves the result. Okay, another result, which I'll just show to you without proving, is that, well, these are the general parameters of a code. So n is the total number of qubits in the system. K is the number of encoded qubit, which means if you have this Hamiltonian and the ground space is 2 to the k fold degenerate, then you have like k qubits encoded in it. Okay, and D is what we've seen before, the minimum distance. Well, in 2D, we were able to prove this trade-off here. K, the number of encoded qubit, is bounded by N divided by D squared. This is not, of course, the first trade-off between these parameters. There are a lot of them that go back like to the 90s. So there's the singleton's bound, also the Knilla-Flam bound, I guess people call it, which says K is bounded by this quantity here, the Hamming bound. Notice that in all these cases, it's K is bounded by N minus something, you know, N minus something, well, here it's N divided by D squared, okay? So specializing to two dimension puts severe constraint on how you can encode information. We also note that this is tight because you can achieve it with Kitaev's code. Yep. Okay. So string-like logical operator. So now I want to get back on track and talk about this thermal stability. Okay. And this was a result that was derived by Ha and Preskill, and it follows again very simply from the holographic disentangling lemma. I won't prove it to you in the interest of time, but we could already kind of guess it. Remember when I said that the bulky errors are not a problem, it's the skinny ones that need to worry? So like the smallest errors are typically the logical operators, right? The one that take you from one ground state to another. And this is what this result says. It says that there exists a non-trivial logical operator, so something that takes you from one ground state to another ground state, okay, that is supported on a string-like region. Okay, so it's something that we kind of hinted on previously because we saw that the skinny errors are problematic. So now it says that it's possible to go from one ground state to the other by affecting only the qubits that live on a like 1D strip. Okay, this was known for Kitaev's code. This is what I showed you before, right? These logical operators were string. It's also kind of very intuitive for models that support anions. So think about this. Let's think of your like the most well-known system, maybe the fractional quantum Hall fluid. Okay. So this thing, if you put it on a torus, it has degenerate ground space. Okay. The different ground states are labeled by the flux through the torus. So what do you do if you want to change the flux? You will create a pair of magnetic vortices. You will drag one around the torus, and then it will go through the hole, and you will annihilate it with its original partner. Well, this all happened on 1D, right? I created them, I dragged one around, so this entire process is one-dimensional. So it's very intuitive if a system has anions that this will be true. But here, I didn't say anything about anions in this talk. I just gave myself a mathematical structure, this commuting projector codes, so I can't just rely on this intuition. Okay, so let's take this for granted. We have these operators that live on 1D regions. So now I would like to show that this implies thermal instability in the sense that there is no energy barrier like in the 2D Ising model. Okay? And here's how I'm going to do this. So maybe here I did even further coarse graining, and I assume that this logical operator lives really like on this one row of my lattice. If it's not true, I can always coarse grain and assume that it's true. And here are what the relevant projectors look like. Okay, so there's a projector that acts here, and maybe I did some additional coarse graining to get this form, but I can always assume that this is the case. So there's a projector that acts on particle 1 and 2, 2 and 3, 3 and 4, and so on. Okay? So what I know is that there exists a unitary operator that lives on this strip that takes me from one ground state to another. Okay, this is what I know. But I don't know what it is. And if it were a tensor product of operator acting on the first size seconds, I could just apply it sequentially. And this would be like the picture of a particle moving. Okay? But I don't know this. It might be like an entangling operator that acts on the entire strip. So here's what I will do. My goal here, I'm like an environment, an adversarial environment, and I'm trying to corrupt the information, and I don't want to pay a lot of energy. Okay? That's my goal. So let's see what I can do. So I will just randomize these first two qubits. Okay? Just apply a random unitary to them, or simply throw them in the bit bucket and replace them by random qubits. Okay. This will kind of excite these two projectors, because these two projectors will no longer be satisfied. And I'll use this color code. Whenever something's red, it means it's no longer satisfied. Okay. Okay, so now these two projectors are not satisfied. What I'll do? I'll just measure this first projector that acts on particle 1 and 2. If I don't get the answer that I want, which is like it's in its ground state, I will just re-randomize these two particles. And I will do this until I find that this projector is back on its minimum energy eigenstate. And once I've done this, I will randomize. So now this guy is black again. Okay, it's satisfied. And only this one is excited. And now I will randomize the third site. And this will excite this projector. And I will measure projector on particle 2 and 3 and randomize particle 3 until I succeed, and so on. And I guess you get the idea. This is kind of moving the excitation along the chain. Now, a few things, a few comments. It should be clear from this picture that there's only a constant amount of energy, because there's always at most two red projectors in this picture. Okay, I don't move forward until I've painted one projector in black again. There's no need to backtrack. This is slightly less obvious, but like, a failed measurement of this guy doesn't mess up this guy, because the projectors mutually commute. Okay, this is crucial. The number of step is proportional to the lattice size. And this one is not entirely trivial, but if I succeed, so I manage to go from this site to the last one, I will have corrupted the information. I guess this one is quite intuitive, but it requires a bit of proving. So what's left? What's not clear here? Well, maybe I will iterate this an infinite number of times. Okay, maybe I have a dead end where I keep randomizing this site, measuring this projector, randomizing, measuring, and so on, and it never stops. Okay, how do I know that this doesn't happen? Well, you need a bit of math. So let me just define two things, and this is the only slide with some math on it, if you don't count the previous ones. So P is like a successful measurement, okay? So P tells you, yeah, okay, I've succeeded in measuring this projector, I'm moving forward, and Q is the opposite of that, okay? I did not succeed, and D is the depolarizing channel, because I use the depolarizing channel all the time because I randomize some qubits, okay? So here's what a typical sequence looks like. I randomize, I measure, and I don't get the answer I want. Randomize, don't get the answer I want. Randomize, don't get the answer. Randomize, and I get the answer. Okay, so this is a sequence, what it looks like. There are some nice properties of this sequence, and the average number of time I need to repeat is this thing here. So here's my initial state. I randomize, get the wrong answer, randomize, get the wrong answer, m times, and then randomize, get the right answer, and I have to sum over all values of m. Okay, and this will give me the average time I need to wait. So you recognize this as a geometric sum, so you can just write it this way. And here's the nice thing. These are now all microscopically defined quantity. I know I'm going a bit fast here, but the point is that there's nothing here that depends on the lattice size. Okay? So the time it takes at every iteration to move forward depends only on microscopic property of the model, not on it doesn't scale with the system size. So, well, you see it's this operator that determines how much time it takes. Here it is again. So you see, it would be a problem if this superoperator had eigenvalue 1, because this would go to infinity, of course. That would be the problem. And here's the observation that we made in this paper. If this thing has eigenvalue 1, then the topological quantum order condition that I stated at the beginning, that was by Bravi, Miklaklis, and Hastings, is violated. Okay, and this leads to this conclusion that was obtained with my student Olivier Landon-Cardinal. The minimum set of requirement that we know to prove thermal stability implies that there cannot exist implies that there exists a sequence of local map that corrupt the system at an energy cost bounded by a constant. So you see, at the end, it's the topological order condition that saves us. Because if we had dead ends, then it might take an infinite amount of time to move forward. And this condition tells us that you can. Okay? So this is the main result. You see that there is a direct trade-off. If you have all the conditions that you need to have this spectral stability, okay, that the eigenvalues don't jitter as a function of time, then there can be no energy barrier between the ground states. So you can have both quantum stability against like quantum fluctuation, and thermal stability. There's a trade-off between these two things. So lots of open questions. let's see. So what we've shown here is that there exists string-like logical operator, and combining this with topological quantum order condition shows that there can be at most a constant energy barrier between ground state. Now, this idea of an energy barrier, which is how I motivated the entire talk, is actually misleading. Because think about the 2D Ising model, very simple, right? We said that there's an energy barrier square root of n between the two ground state. How much energy is in the system at temperature T? There's kBTn, right? So there's plenty of energy in the system to overcome this energy barrier. Okay, so the energy barrier thing is misleading. So how come is there a finite Curie temperature in 2D? Okay, it's not about this energy barrier. So why are there like two stable phase for the 2D Ising model? The point is that if I ask you, okay, so we have plenty of energy in the system. Now let's fix the average energy, and let's count the number of configuration that have like these big error bubbles, okay? And compare this to configuration that have lots of small bubbles, okay? The small bubble completely overwhelms, okay? So it's very, very, very unlikely that a very big bubble will form and flip the entire thing, okay? So it's really about entropy. It's not about energy. That's just repeating what I'm saying. So if we wanted to have a complete result for these quantum memories and have instability, it's not enough to like show the existence of a string-like operator. We would need to count them. How many string operators? Just like we need to count bubbles in the 2D Ising model. Okay, so this was the first comment to say that this result is not complete. The other thing is that this noise model, this adversarial noise model that I've shown, kind of moves forward, and eventually it has to walk across the entire lattice. So you could say, well, you know, this takes a time proportional to the linear size of the lattice, which is pretty good. Just make a very big lattice and you'll have a very good memory. In fact, I don't think this is how it would work in reality. I think these processes would be happening in parallel throughout the lattice, you know, like you would have this, the process that I described would be happening here and here and here and everywhere. And when these things percolate, then you lose the information. So, and therefore it's about percolation time, and this becomes a constant independent of the lattice size. Right, and more generally, as I told you, if it was an anyon model, the argument would be trivial, okay? You don't need any of these things. So is there a relation? I've given, you know, a mathematical setup. Is this setup identical to anyon model? You know, is it the case that every time you obey these constraints that I defined at the beginning of the talk, then systematically you have anyons? This is, I think, an interesting open question. Can we engineer dead ends? Okay, so this would be a situation where you keep, you know, you try to push your defect forward and you keep failing, okay? So can we engineer this? We would have to break the topological order condition, but this would be something that could lead to a memory that is stable, not because of an energy barrier, but because of a complexity barrier. So the picture I like to have in mind is a maze, right? So maybe like there exists a very low energy path that corrupts the memory, but it's buried in all these dead ends. Okay, and like if you're a random environment, you will just walk, and it's very unlikely that you find the exit to this maze. So I don't know if this can be realized. There are various extensions, and I guess then that boils down to Seth's question: what about frustration-free Hamiltonian? And if we could do this, it would extend to all gapped Hamiltonian just by some mathematical trick that Hastings has developed. That's it. So. Thanks very much for your attention.
So you elegantly showed us here that it's tough to build the dream of quantum memory in two dimensions, but you mentioned that it is possible in four dimensions. So what about three dimensions?
Well, so okay, yeah, I should mention actually recent work. So Zhang Wenhua has constructed a three-dimensional system that whose excited. So you see, 1D Ising model point like domain walls. 2D Ising model string like domain walls. And John Wall was able to construct a 3D quantum system whose excitations or domain wall were fractal. Okay? So their dimension is between 1 and 2. But unfortunately, with some simulation that they did, Monte Carlo simulation that they did with Sergey Bravi, they found that it was not stable. So despite having like, so the energy barrier grows, I'm not sure what the growth is. There was a sequel to this, and we can get an energy growth that is like n to the 1/3, okay? But then it depends also, as I was mentioning at the end, not only on the energy growth, it depends also on the statistics and the number of such configuration, and all the existing, these two systems that we know of in 3D, they're not thermally stable. But they do have a growing energy barrier, but it's not enough to make them thermally stable. But it remains open. Yeah. Yes?
So, with regard to the last point about frustration free Hamiltonian,
yes.
The intuition would be that what you care about is the code space.
Yes.
And so you just want the projectors to commute on the code space. The problem is, you're specifically addressing thermal stability. And for a code, an error in correcting and coding system in contact with that, you're never going to be in the ground state. You have to worry about how things work as you move out. So it's not obvious to me that the frustration-free is the complete dead end. Is there any other reason?
The frustration-free is?
Is there any other reason to believe that frustration-free would equate to commuting?
Oh, no. No, it's just a hope that, you know, some of the math will go true. Other than that, they can be physically quite different system. I agree. Because you care about excitations here. Yeah.
All right, then. Well, let's thank David again.